Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and in this underlined reason number 6, I will be speaking about women and perfume. It's kind of like finally we face to face with this very poignant issue of a Muslim woman. Can a Muslim woman just wear regular perfume and goes outside to do her business like on a daily day like every other human being? Or is it not permitted? If you go on the internet, and it's called the internet, looking for an answer, 99.99% you will find there that it is not. They won't tell you it's prohibited. They go a step further and they tell you it is haram. And to know the difference between what's haram and what's prohibited, I strongly encourage you to go on my YouTube channel, Islaam Pep-Talk, and listen to the 19 things that were made haram and are halal, where I explain the concepts of haram and prohibited, because there is a huge difference. But anyway, a Muslim person that you are, my sister, especially if you listen to this talk here, you've read Al-Quran either in Arabic or the translation of some of the meanings, and you never came across a direct command from Allah where it tells a woman, do not put perfume on and go outside. In fact, you read in Al-Quran what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, that is the surah number 2, in the ayah 222, where Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Allah loves at-tawwabin, those who repent from sins. Continuously they repent from sins. And mutatahirin, those who purify themselves. And how Allah in this ayah here has linked between the spiritual purification, and that is the repentance, and the physical purification, and that is the cleanliness, and anything that we do to be clean and be nice and smell nice and look nice and all that kind of stuff. So, but that is what Al-Quran says. But you, my sister, and you, my brother, you come up and you find these texts, because as a brother, it's either you are a father, or you are a brother, or you are a husband. You are in one of them categories, or maybe you don't have a sister, and still you have a mother. But anyhow, so you come with text that tells you that if a woman wears perfume outside, it is haram. Now, if a woman must ask a question as to why is it haram, what things like that, she is slapped on their hands, as we cannot ask questions. And this ideology is extremely dangerous. This is a dogmatic, this is a dogma. You know, a dogma is you gotta believe in something, you cannot challenge or ask questions about these things. In the days of old, a woman, and when I mean the days of old, I mean before Islam, when Rasulullah ﷺ came, and then after Rasulullah ﷺ went. The period where Rasulullah ﷺ was alive, women truly enjoyed a completely different aspect in their lives. They were completely different, and I will mention a few examples, inshallah, in this and in the next ones. And if you've been listening at the underlying series, you've heard what I've said and how things are really different from what's being preached today. Take the period where Rasulullah ﷺ was alive, women did enjoy. After that and before that, they suffered and they suffered, and they still are suffering until today. And not much has changed today. It's still told that when a woman goes outside, she must walk close to a wall, because in the middle of the pavement, it's the mens provence. That's where men are, and women must not compete with men. When she goes out, she must not smell anything. In fact, some of the scholars, they say she must not only not smell, but she should smell bad, so that no man will, I'm sorry for this, I'm not taking the mic, but it's just like so crazy that it makes you laugh. It's hysterical. Is that a woman, not only she mustn't smell good, but she has to smell bad so that men do not get attracted to her. And if she goes out, she must cover from head to toes, and they will bring you Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said that only one eye shows. And the list goes on. Basically, what they're trying to say is this. When a woman needs to move out to do something, if she could take her house or her room with her and go that errand and come back, then that is the best thing to do. My dear sisters and my brothers, not much has changed these days. And the most important thing is, and this is always the reference I go back to, is what happens in Saudi Arabia. The reason being is the split personality of that country has created a huge problem around the world. A, it's the way they look at Islam. It's very tribal, very barbaric, very sectarian, very honorable, very it's me. And because Allah gave them Mecca and Al-Madinah, He didn't give it to them. It was rather more taken from the Muslims, because back then, all Muslims had a share of Al-Madinah and Mecca until Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and Al Saud came and they killed and they murdered to take control of what's called today called the Saudi Arabia. And then when they found petrol and they became rich, yeah, Allah please save us, they took the Wahhabi movement and spread it around the world. Of course, they packaged it as a Salafi thing so that it is easily acceptable. So these people, they took their understanding of Islam based on their Bedouin origins, and they wanted to promote it to the rest of the world. And the calamity is they wanted to make the whole world a small place, Saudi Arabia or some part land, desert or something like that, and they managed so far. And we are fighting back to get our Islam back to how in that period of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam it was. The male scholars throughout history, they did encourage the male gender to use perfume. In fact, there is an agreement between the scholars in which they say that if a man, any man, rich man, poor man, anyone, if he spent 1/3 of his fortune on perfumes, he is not considered a waster. Now, if logic had to work here, you would understand that these people are really unjust, because they base this statement on an authentic hadith reported by An-Nasa'i alayhi rahmatullah, and it's authenticated by Al-Imam Al-Hakim and Al-Dhahabi, and also by Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani in Fath al-Bari. I say these names maybe to you, they don't make much sense, but for whoever wants really to go deeper, or maybe for people who listen to my talks and want to answer whatever, they know what I got from, so that they can go back to this thing and they will understand that I am not saying these things from my own pocket, but it is the other side of the hidden coins that they hide away from you, so that you don't know. They only tell you one version and they keep the other part hidden. But I'll tell you both sides and I tell you where they come from, so you know what you are up to. And actually, you would find out that the Islam that Allah wants you to have is a lot simpler. The other day I was listening to one of the talks, and one of the sheikhs said something absolutely beautiful. He said, the highway, al-Islam, as a highway by Allah, he goes, it's one huge lane. On both sides, you've got beautiful sceneries. Right in front of you, you've got beautiful sceneries and the sun and the sea, calm sea. And he goes, and you can drive at a speed that is comfortable to you. You can stop whenever you want. You can enjoy whatever you want. That is the Islam of Al-Quran. And then he goes, but the Islam of the man of religions and hadith is like a very busy city where every 200 yards you have a red traffic light. Every 50 yards you've got pedestrians crossings, and cars are the street has got like four lanes, and all of them are filled with cars. You can't drive, you can't enjoy. It's just a headache being in the city. And Allah, how true is this Sheikh Jazakallah Khair for that description? And it's absolutely beautiful. So let's get on the highway to Allah, on the Quran waves, and see where it will lead us. The hadith they refer to, back to that third, it's not, if someone spends third of their wealth on perfumes, is not considered a waster. And they consider that because Rasulullah ﷺ said, حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ مِن دُنْيَاكُمْ, endeared, it was me made dear to me from your world, women, and nisa'u, وَالطِّيب, and perfume. And then he said, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ, and my true comfort is truly in as-salat, not the blackness of my eyes, as some people they translate it. It's like metaphorical, it's hypothetical expression that the Arabs use. Qurratu ayni, i.e. my true comfort is in as-salat. Now, when they say if someone spends the third of his wealth on perfume is not considered a waster, they say it's because Rasulullah split the luxuries of this life into three: women, perfume, and salat. But salat is not part of this world. It's an act of to mention the name of Allah. It should be half. But anyhow, so they want to do this, and it's a headache, and it's you really don't want to bother, but it's there. And of course, they manipulated the meaning of this hadith, because when Rasulullah says, حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ مِن دُنْيَاكُمْ النِّسَاء وَالطِّيب, they made it only on men, that Rasulullah ﷺ said that he was only addressing men, because Rasulullah ﷺ loves women and women don't love women in the sexual cohabital way. So he's only talking to men. But okay, we'll give them that. But also when it comes to at-tib and as-salat, both men and women share that together. So what made you only believe that he was only referring to as when it comes to men and not women? But this is also some of the laws they put, and I'll get back to them later on, inshallah. Of course, they wouldn't just exclude women from such a deal without a reason. And their reason is that if there is another hadith which prohibits women from the usage of perfume, then that hadith will take precedence over any other hadith. What do they mean by this? If one hadith says don't go, and there is another hadith that says go, they will always bring forth the hadith that says go over the one that says don't go. Believe it or not, our scholars, till today, I read some things, and when we study them, I always debated, how did they come up with that? Where it is in Al-Quran? Before, there was only one book. Al-Islam was just one book, Al-Quran. Today we have thousands upon thousands upon thousands of books that are Al-Islam, and we are so confused. Anyway, I'm going now to mention the evidences provided and then discuss them one by one, provided for them to prohibit again that a woman should wear perfume when she goes out. The most biggest evidence is the Quran. And I am happy to say that there is nothing, a thing in the book of Allah that explicitly or implicitly prohibits a woman or encourages a man to wear the perfume. And that is that when Allah says Allah loves at-tawwabin, the repenters, and those who clean themselves, He spoke about men and women. There is no ayah that says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, or you men wear perfume, you women don't wear perfume. There is no such a thing of that. So where does this prohibition come? Well, it comes from a hadith. When you look at the hadith, there are around 20 to 30 hadiths that deal with this issue. However, these 20, 30 hadiths, most of them are weak and most of them are unauthentic. And all of them, they root from four of these hadith. So I'm going to take these four hadith that are the most authentic ones and deal with them one by one so that you make up your mind as to what comes up next. The very first hadith, and this hadith is reported in Ahmad ibn Hanbal and also in An-Nasa'i, and it is good, and Al-Hassan al-Albani, Sheikh al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, said it is a good hadith. And again, when I deal with the science of hadith, I will explain what is the difference between the hadith that is authentic, sahih, and the hadith that is just hasan and good. The hadith reads like this: أَيُّمَا مَرَأَةٍ اسْتَعْطَرَتْ, any woman who puts on perfume, استعطرت, and I will explain, فَمَرَّتْ عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ, then passes by a people, and these people are men, لِيَجِدُوا مِنْ رِيحِهَا, so that they smell from her fragrance, فَهِيَ زَانِيَةٌ, she is considered a zaniya. But actually the wordings of the hadith, they point a finger at her and they say she is a fornicator or an adulterer. Now to the wordings of the hadith. أَيُّمَا مْرَأَةٍ, any woman, استعطرت. In Arabic, there is a great difference between تعطرت, عطرت, استعطرت. In Arabic, when the word, for example, عطرت, عطرت, it's four letters. If you add تعطرت, if you add one letter, you are adding a meaning to the verb. If you add two more letters, you are adding another new meaning, a far bigger meaning to the word. And this is how Arabic is just built on letters. So here when it says istatarat, it means she put the perfume purposefully for a reason. And then Rasulullah ﷺ later on explains the reason. لِيَجِدُوا مِنْ رِيحَا. So her purpose is, she deliberately, strategically chose what perfume she puts on, the amount she would put on, and the reason why she's doing that. And then she goes out and passes by a group of men for the sole purpose of her making them desire her. In other ways, she goes out to pull up some men. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, فَهِيَ زَانِيَةٌ. Then she is a fornicator. I will get back to this hadith later on. So point number two, the hadith number two is this, reported by Imam Muslim in his Sahih. إِذَا شَهِدَتْ إِحْدَى كُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ فَلَا تَمَسَّ طِيبًا. If one of you attends the masjid, let her not touch perfume. And as I said, it is reported by Muslim. The third hadith is, أَيُّمَا مْرَأَةٍ أَصَابَتْ بَخُورًا. Any woman who has touched perfume or perfumed herself, فَلَا تَشْهَدْ مَعَنَا الْعِشَاءَ الْآخِرَةِ. Let her not attend the last Isha prayer with us in the masjid. And this hadith is also reported by Muslim. The fourth hadith is, أَيُّمَا مْرَأَةٍ تَطَيَّبَتْ. Any woman who perfumed herself, ثُمَّ خَرَجَتْ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ, then goes out to the masjid, لَمْ تُقْبَلْ لَهَا صَلَاةٌ حَتَّى تَغْتَسِلْ. No salat shall be accepted from her until she takes a bath. And this hadith is reported by Ibn Majah and has been authenticated by Al-Albani, who considers it sahih. Basically, these are the four most authentic hadith. And as I said early on, the rest are weak, and all of them scholars have spoken against. So we can disregard them in the peace of mind that we have the four evidences that you will see and read on every time you search this issue. Now, let us take a look at the hadith one by one to see what really lingers with these hadith. Number one. أيما امرأة استطرت. Any woman who puts on perfume then passes by a people, these are men, so that they smell her fragrance, is a zania, i.e. a fornicator. This hadith, my dear sisters and my brother, in the chain of the narrators, as in Ahmad, An-Nasa'i, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Khuzayma, Ibn Hibban, and finally Al-Hakim. These are the books where you can find this hadith. This hadith is traced to someone called Thabit Ibn Umara. Thabit, son of Amara al-Hanafi. And this man here, who is in the chain of this hadith here, is a man that is not agreed upon by all scholars of hadith. What this means is, few of them see he is a good, and few of others see he is not a good person. And now, based on which scholar of hadith looks at the hadith, what I mean by this? Again, just like in Islam they have the school of thoughts, the scholars of hadith also have school of thoughts. Some of them, they will say, if this man, for example, Thabit ibn Umara, has been authenticated by al-Bukhari, for me that's good enough. Others, they will say, no. Even if authenticated by al-Bukhari, it still is not good because, for example, Ahmed ibn Hanbal said that this man cannot be reliable. And this creates a headache for you and myself. For example, Yahya ibn Ma'in, who is a huge, the Einstein of hadith, he said that this man, Thabit ibn Umara, is reliable, he is trustworthy. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, alayhi rahmatullah, he says he is okay. And when he says he is okay, in other words, to me, he is not that reliable, he's not that trustworthy. Abu Dawood, the man of the Sunan, he says he's a trustworthy person. But An-Nasa'i says, لا بأس به, he is okay. And in this situation here, the scholars who deem this person as just okay will not accept his hadith as authentic, while the others will accept as authentic. Ali ibn al-Madini, who was again one of the friends of Imam Ahmed, when asked about Thabit ibn Umara, he answered, so and so are stronger than him. Meaning that he is a weak reporter of the hadith. Abu Hatim al-Razi said, this man here, he is from Al-Basra, and for me, he is nothing. And Abu Hatim al-Razi is also another Einstein of Al-Hadith alayhi rahmatullah. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi said, Saduq, he is okay, he could be trustworthy, he could speak the truth, but he is okay. And Ibn Hajar alayhi rahmatullah, he goes, he is a truthful speaker, but he is lean when it comes. He is not that stringent, he is not that strong when he reports a hadith. Well, the general conclusion about this man in the books of hadith is that he is honest and nearing the status of a reliable. He is not reliable, but he is nearing the status of reliable. If we had to go to a court today, if we take this to a court of law today, and we tell them all, we've got this witness here, and here is what the people speak about the witness. You know what the court of law is going to say? They're going to reject the whole thing because they are contradictory statements. If this is in court of law, in a man-made law in this life, how about the religion? Am I going to accept a religion based on someone who reports the hadith, who could be reliable, while others say he is not reliable? Subhanallah, why do we leave Al-Quran to this headache of the science of hadith? And this is why this hadith here about the woman who puts on perfume and goes out, passes by a man so that they find her, think her smell, she is a fornicator, this hadith has been weakened by a great number of scholars. Obviously, if I am of the opinion that a woman must not put perfume, guess what? I will go with the views of those who say this hadith is authentic. But since I not of that view that a woman shouldn't put perfume, I go with the views of the woman who the scholars who say that this hadith is weak. And also to me, as a speaker here, I don't care what these people say to me. It's initially what happens in Al-Quran and the practical acts of Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as I will explain later on again. This hadith has got another problem as well, and that is calling a perfumed woman a zaniya. A zaniya in Al-Quran is subhanallah, is only when the act of penetration takes place. That is zina. Kissing, touching, grabbing, everything that people can do is not considered zina and is considered a minor sin. Only the act of penetration is the major sin, and that is what is considered as a huge thing. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith here that they say Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called a woman a zaniya, a fornicator, would a messenger who understands fully the intent of Allah call a woman who just puts on perfume as a zaniya? This is why a lot of people, they say this is qadf. Al-qadf is when you throw a pebble with strength to hurt somebody. But in Islam, when we say rajulun qadhafa imra'a, a man has thrown something on woman, is when he accuses her of sexual behavior and the woman is innocent. And subhanallah, the reward of people who do this, and this is about man and woman, if someone comes and speaks sexually against you and you are innocent, that man or that woman deserves 80 lashes regardless of your sex. So they could make up a story about a man and they say something about him that is not sexually correct, and then they have made the qadf. Listen to what Allah says in Al-Quran. وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ. And as for those who threw strongly accusations upon chaste women, or man here, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَأْتُ بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءَ, and then they do not produce four witnesses to support their accusations. Allah says, فَاجْلِدُوهُمْ ثَمَانِينَ جَلْدَةً, flog them with 80 lashes. وَلَا تَقْبَلُوا لَهُمْ شَهَادَةً أَبَدًا, and do not accept any testimony from them forever. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ, and those are truly the immoral evil doers. So as you can see, for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to throw a blanket statement that any woman who puts on perfume is called a zaniya, that is a huge statement from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I am sure he wouldn't make that statement sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as such, it is not befit of our messenger to throw such a huge sexual accusation against an honorable, chaste woman who just put on perfume. And her intention is not to drag or bring any man or pick up or pull any guys at all. She just put on perfume to go to work. Furthermore, the hadith speaks about a woman who intentionally does what she does for one single purpose, and that is to pull men for sexual intentions. So I pray to Allah this is clear, even though the hadith is weak as a whole. To have a better understanding about women going outside with perfume and why has it been such a big stigma, big issue, we have to take it within the context of the time. Because back then, 1,400 years ago, or even maybe 100 years ago or so, perfume was not as spread as it is today. Before, perfume was only, and this is going to maybe surprise you, and only the extreme luxury people, the rich people, would put perfume, and they have their dedicated perfume. But other than that, before, if someone wanted to gift a woman, a man wanted to court a woman or maybe make her present, they always buy her what? Perfume. It was for women to wear perfume. Back in the cultures of the days, like 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years ago, and even maybe a few hundred years back in time, until perfume became very spread, perfume was a sign for erotic relationship between a man and his wife. They would only put perfume for sexual encounter. They would not put perfume on a daily basis. So if a woman goes outside and she had perfume on her, to them, it is either she just had been with her husband to bed for sex, or she is looking, it always had a connotation with sexuality. Perfume has always been a luxury and a domain for the rich and women. And this is not only for the Arabs, it is world renowned and worldly spread. The scholars of the Jews, for example, used to say, and I've read it personally myself, and I make this research here, that any male, it is in the Torah and the Talmud and the laws of the Jews, even these days when they give the fatwa, go to the websites and or maybe just run a search, perfume in the Bible or the Torah, and you will read some stuff that you will find in our books of fiqh. So when man asks the rabbi about wearing perfume, the rabbi say, and this was their fatwa before, and now it's changed a little bit, they used to consider any male wearing perfume as a cross-dresser, because perfume was dedicated for women. And before, a woman would give a perfume as a gift to a woman, because that was how the cookie crumbled back then. The idea behind it was that when either the man wanted to sleep with his wife, or when the wife wanted to sleep with her husband, they would just put the perfume, or the husband would just put some perfume on his wife, and that was the signal for it. And till now, that is being the influence behind all these fatwas that we are living today, is that when a woman goes outside, always remember, the scholars of Saudi Arabia, they are Bedouins. They maybe never been away from Saudi Arabia. So they still live with that mentality of a Bedouin, so much so that if a woman comes out from her home with a perfume, to them straight away it means sex. And this is where the problem is. If they only traveled around the world to discover that the world has evolved and we no longer are in the year 65 after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, I imagine a woman living in these circumstances somewhere in the depth of Africa or in the Bedouin worlds of the Gulf and things like that, or some parts of the world where when a woman, nobody wears a perfume, and when a woman comes out with a perfume, then yes, I can understand all the wrong signs and signals and indications that that act does and give. But this is not, the world is not Saudi Arabia. And Islam is not for Saudi Arabia, for the love of Allah. Islam is for humanity as a whole, from people in the most advanced of the cities to the most remote of villages around the world. Now, let's now look at hadith number 2 and 3, because they are pretty much the same thing. These two hadith are specific to a particular time. The one of them, it says, if one of them attends the masjid, let her not touch any perfume at all. And the other one says that if any woman who has perfumed herself or put on any kinds of perfume on her, she must not go and perform the Isha prayer. And again, at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, look at it like this. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam being the head of the state in his time. And he knows, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that women, Isha is the last prayer. And we don't even know when this hadith was said. Was it said in winter, like when it's the Isha is early, or was it said in summer when Isha is late? We don't know when it was. We're going to kind of like assume it's between the two, yeah? Women should be home, and that is when people go to sleep. But a woman leaves her home in the darkness. There were no street lights, and there was nothing of that thing there. And she walks in the darkness of the night to go to the masjid, perform a salat. And at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, not everyone was as pious as they want us to believe that. At the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there were people, there were perverts, there were people who chased women, just like you would think of the world today. So if a woman came out from her home at night in Isha and to go to the masjid to perform her Salat al-Isha, and she was perfumed. So what do you think? What is the signal? What is the message that she's sending out? Well, then Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, well, such woman does that, she should not come to the masjid. Let her stay at home, because it gives all kinds of wrong messages. And these two hadiths are in Muslims, and this can be applied even today in England or in America or New York City or Los Angeles or wherever you want to go. If I would tell a woman, if you are at home and you are going for an errand late at night, don't perfume yourself. Even you women, you know this in the depth of your own heart. You don't do these things because it can get you in all kinds of trouble. Why do you think women avoid eye contact with guys? Why? It's because they know an eye contact can lead to a smile, to a high, to, and it can lead to a lot of trouble. Well, trouble, depending on how you look at it. But it leads to all kinds of things. Maybe the woman doesn't want them. So when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said Hadith 2 and 3, they are exactly for specific moment, and he named them Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and that is Salat al-Isha. The other Hadith, and the fourth Hadith here, is the Hadith where it says that any woman who perfumes herself then goes out to the masjid, no salat shall be accepted from her until she takes a bath. And as I said, it was reported by Ibn Majah and authenticated by Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. However, there is a man that has been weakened and even called Munkar al-Hadith, i.e. the Hadiths he mentions are all rejected. And this Hadith is weak by all kinds of means, except Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. And as I said before, Al-Albani just follows a school of thought that he deems, but there are many other school of thoughts when it comes to a hadith authentication or unauthentication. So that fourth hadith is a weak hadith. So let us now look at the issue of women and perfume at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I see it's reached 32 minutes. Maybe I should stop here and carry on part number 2. So I will stop here, inshallah, and carry on part number 2 about women and perfume at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and if there were women who wore perfumes, and inshallah, you're going to be surprised. So just until next talk.